Do you want to optimize your app development with a single code base while maintaining the native feel? Discover Kotlin Multiplatform and Compose Multiplatform with me and learn how to develop an Android and iOS app from one code base. Hi guys, my name is Henrik Reis. I hope you're doing well and I welcome you to a new video. If you're familiar with mobile app development or also cross-platform frameworks, you probably already heard about frameworks like Flutter, React Native, or Xamarin. When it comes to developing mobile apps in React Native, for example, you have the option of using either JavaScript or TypeScript. Having this option is particularly beneficial for web developers as they can easily transition to mobile app development without the hassle of learning two entire native frameworks as well as two distinct programming languages. At the end, all cross-platform frameworks, from React Native to Flutter, share a common approach. Rather than relying on native toolkits from Google and Apple, they enable us to build Android and iOS apps from a single codebase. However, in the recent years, a new star has emerged in the world of cross-platform frameworks. I'm talking about Kotlin Multiplatform. While the framework has gained popularity in the past 2 years, its initial release for code sharing between the JVM and JavaScript dates back to 2017. Since then, the platform, which was developed by JetBrains, has entered beta status and is on the cusp of first stable release. Just as a small correction from the off, meanwhile, after the recording, Kotlin Multiplatform went stable. When it comes to mobile app development, Kotlin Multiplatform allows us to write our business logic in Kotlin and distribute it as auto-generated platform code to Android or iOS modules. This approach sets us apart from other cross-platform frameworks we mentioned earlier. Instead of sharing all the code, we're not confined to a cross-platform UI toolkit. With this approach, we can still utilize native UI toolkits and native platform APIs as if we were developing a native mobile app. Sounds good, right? But is it really worth it, the extra effort, when we can achieve everything in one single codebase using Flutter, for example? The answer, as you might expect it, depends on your use case. But don't click away just yet. There's another approach that can enhance the power of Kotlin Multiplatform. Let me introduce you to Compose Multiplatform. It builds up on Kotlin Multiplatform and expands the hybrid approach we discussed earlier into a fully functional cross-platform framework. Compose Multiplatform enables us not only to share the business logic of our application as with a bare-bone KMP project, but also to share the user interface in one codebase. And if you're already familiar with Android Jetpack Compose, you feel right at home because the API remains the same. Therefore, Compose Multiplatform might also is interesting for you if you haven't touched iOS development yet, but always wanted to bring an app to not only the Android ecosystem, but also to iOS. To start, let's take a look at a practical example. And to do so, we can go to the Compose Multiplatform website here, and then we click on Get Started, and we will be redirected to the GitHub page or the GitHub repository of Compose Multiplatform. And now, because we want to build an iOS app, of course, there are also other options. So you can also develop a desktop app or even a web app if you use Kotlin Multiplatform. Just as I said, we want to choose here iOS. And then you can see that you will land on a template repository here. So it says Compose Multiplatform iOS Android template. And to start a new project, we can just make use of this template here. So a lot of stuff will be already set up for us. So just click on use this template, then create a new repository. And here we can say sample project compose multiplatform, for example. And then I will just use a private repository here. And as you can see, the repository gets generated for us. And now I have here my new private repository. And the next step, of course, is to check the repository out in Android Studio. When you have successfully cloned your project to your operating system and open it up in Android Studio, you should see this structure here. And the first thing we want to do is to switch from the Android view here to the project view. So let's have a deeper look at this project structure, because it's a good thing to know what you're working with at the end. So we have three important modules here. One is the Android app, and here you can see you have a known structure for an Android app. Then you also have an iOS app, which for example contains here an Xcode project and the regular configurations. So you could just open this up in Xcode. And then you also have a shared module. And this shared module, on the other hand, once again contains a folder or module for Android, one for iOS, and one common module. So, and if you're implementing business logic in this hybrid approach we talked about, you would implement all your code here in this common main, and then you could access it in, yeah, imagine it like a library inside the iOS app and also the Android app. So you would access it in your regular native platform code. In the Android app, of course, you would have Kotlin code, and in the iOS app, on the other hand, you would have Objective-C code, which compiles from this shared code. So, but what if we have code that doesn't act the same on both platforms? What do we do in this case? For this case, we can make use of the expected actual pattern. And this pattern works like essentially like an interface. So you define here, for example, get platform name. So on Android, that should be Android, and on iOS, that should be iOS. And then in our Android main module here, we just say the actual implementation is Android. And on the iOS side, of course, we have here iOS. Inside those modules here, you can access also native platform code. So if you want to implement, for example, receiving the location of the app or something like that, you could access those native code here in both of these modules. However, you will make a lot of use of this if you're using this hybrid approach and implement your UI in these native modules. So with your native platform tooling. In our case, we want to implement a fully cross-functional mobile app. So we want to use Compose Multiplatform. And how can we do that now? Because we checked out the Compose Multiplatform template. This project is already set up for that. And you might already got a sneak peek here. And let's go into this app KT. And if we take a look at this code here, and somewhere in your last years or month of mobile app development, you stumbled about Jetpack Compose, this should feel familiar to you, because you have here a material theme, you have this remember mutable state of, and also the column layout modifiers and so on. So it's essentially really the same like in Android's Jetpack Compose, which is cool because you could, for example, copy layouts from your Android app right into this Compose multiplatform code. Of course, not all of it would work, but at least most of the parts. And let's have a quick look how this actually gets invoked. So because this is just a regular, yeah, composable here. Let's see where this composable gets invoked. And as we see, one invocation lies here in the Android platform code, and the other one in the iOS module here. And this main view controller, where could it be invoked? So let's see. Main iOS content view Swift. It gets invoked in our Swift code. So when the iOS app, for example, starts, it creates the UI based on this main view controller. And that is how our Compose Multiplatform code gets visible on our iOS app. And if we quickly go here into the main activity of our Android code, we can see that we also use here the main view, which refers to the composable of our Compose Multiplatform code. So once again, here also it gets invoked by a regular platform function. So under the hood, it's still this hybrid approach that you still have a native Android app and also a native iOS app. And then we invoke this Compose Multiplatform code, which gets written once in this common main module. So, but let's see if this actually works. So I start here a new Android emulator instance. And then if I go here under all configurations, you can already see that there's also an iOS app. And I would try to start that from here, also from Android Studio. Now after successfully building our app for iOS and Android, we can see here two emulators. One is the iOS emulator, an iPhone 11 Pro, and also a foldable device, which is an Android emulator. So now I can just click on the button here. And as you can see, we see a Jetpack Compose or Compose Multiplatform logo. And the same also goes for the Android simulator. So we achieved the exact same behavior with solely Kotlin and some platform specific code, but it's essentially a fully cross-platform app just developed with Kotlin. And the cool thing here is really that we can use Jetpack Compose for all of that. A quick disclaimer at this point, you cannot build an iOS app without owning a macOS device. Currently here, I'm running this on a MacBook, so I have here macOS, and that's why I'm also able to build this app on my device. But if you're owning, for example, Windows, unfortunately, you can only build an Android app. So in this video, we talked about the foundation of Kotlin Multiplatform and Compose Multiplatform by the example of a template project. This video lays the foundation for my first series of videos on cross-platform development with KMP and Compose Multiplatform. In this series, I will guide you through the everyday tasks you will face when developing a mobile app, from state management with a KMP library called Voyager, to introducing a database with SQLDelight, to network requests with Ktor, and also dependency injection with Coin, and finally, how to write unit tests for our cross-platform code with JUnit tests. So if you're interested in this topic, make sure to like and subscribe, and don't forget to activate the notification bell so you don't miss the next parts of this video series.